Yo, what's good YouTube? This is Jay from TNJ. And if we're looking at this crucial three series in a row, this string of nine games, I believe it is. Is it nine or ten? I don't know. But going up against the Mets, Washington, then the Mets back again. This is the lineup that we're going to roll with. And the reason why is because I'm going to give Gianni Giovitella some run back in the lineup. And the thing that's been hurting us a little bit that's been kind of under the radar is Real Muto at, I mean, he's just hitting so bad. I mean, if you look at him, 221, I mean, he's just not producing at all. I don't know what it is either. I mean, he just all of a sudden just started hitting bad. And you look historically, he's a 271 career average. But last year was actually his second highest as a major leaguer. So I mean, it's hard to find catchers that do hit for high average, but you would think somebody with his skill, he's 83 overall, has good attributes. I mean, he can hit the ball pretty well. If you look at his attributes, you would think that he's a great hitter, but he just is not hitting the ball well. So you know, I would give Austin Nola a little bit more run, but he's not hitting much better at all. And I don't want to move up Taylor Ward. Like I said, I don't want to rush him because I know he is going to be a part of the future. But here's the lineup that I'm going to roll with. I'm going to put Gianni Giovitella in the A spot because I do want to score some runs out of the A spot. One thing that really helped last year is Leury Garcia helped a lot in that A spot, but this year he's not doing it. So I decided to move Gianni Giovitella into the starting lineup and move Adrian Beltre out. You see he's got the snowflake. He's kind of cold. And look at his ratings. I mean, they're going down. I mean, dramatically. I mean, he was at 300, hitting 300 at one point this season. Now he's down to 270 when I started giving him more consistent run. So I think the best role for him is a platoon role. So this is what I'm going to look like right now. And let's just look to see who we're facing. So we're facing pretty much all right-handers the next five games. We do face, I believe, is Gio Gonzalez. So we have Gio Gonzalez in four games. So Adrian Beltre will hit in the lineup that game. But besides that, I think I'm going to keep him in kind of the guy off the bench just in case I need to pinch hit for the pitcher or something with the guys in scoring position. I think I need to play this smart going down the stretch. So I think that's it. Let me get into this game, man. I mean, let's just look at our budget really quick. I just want to look and show you guys who's on the books for next year. So you can see, like, a lot of guys are going to free agency. So JT Realmuto is going to free agency. Adrian Beltre is going to free agency. Danny Valencia, free agent. Justin Bour is a free agent. I mean, like, this is what I was talking about. This is why I made that trade. Josh Bell is going into arbitration, so I do have him. But, you know, a lot of guys I'm losing, and it's going to be kind of alarming a little bit because, like I said, I'm losing my catcher, but Taylor Ward's probably going to take that spot. I'm losing my first baseman, but Josh Bell is going to use that spot. So I'm going to have some holes in the outfield at some point in some part of the infield. I'm going to need to fill some holes. And like I said, I'm banking on Jamai Jones and Asan Diaz and Lucas Salee probably to fill those roles. So we'll see how it goes as far as the future. But let's hop into this game, man. I mean, this is crucial. This is crucial coming down the stretch. So let's not waste any more time. Let's hop into it. Let's get it. So Michael Fulmer is 11-5 this season, and his wins above replacement is probably higher than our division lead right now. I think his WAR is at about 4, and like I said, we have less than a 4-game lead on the Mets and Nationals. So this is a crucial series, and Michael Fulmer to start out this game is hot, getting Cespedes to strike out, this time getting Jackie Bradley to strike out. Next batter comes up and he's gonna whiff Flores. So he has 5 strikeouts in the first 2 innings as he continues this magical season. But onto the 5th inning, here comes Travis d'Arnaud up to the plate, and he drives one deep to left field, and that one's gonna just get over the wall in left field. That's only 344 feet, so he didn't have to hit it too far, but it does get over the stretch glove of Domingo Santana. And the New York Mets take the 1-0 lead on the road as they try to gain some ground on us as well. But onto the 6th inning, I haven't shown much offense in this game early, and that's because, I mean, as you can see, Nothing's really happening on the offensive end. But onto the seventh inning, we do start to get base runners as we do draw the walk. Domingo Santana draws the walk. And on a 3-2 count, Machado does swing at an inside fastball and whiffs on that one. But Justin Bour, who's been hitting pretty good lately, gets a nice pitch to hit up in the zone and takes this one deep to center field. And Justin Bour, like I said, Machado, Bour, and Santana, and now Josh Bell are all like just absolutely raking as far as home runs go. We definitely lead the majors in home runs as a team, but you know, we just have to put together a string of games where we can actually get a lot of hits. And speaking of homers, here is Josh Bell driving one deep, and he gets a home run, and he only makes this a 3-1 game as we just scrape together these runs with these two home runs. And I mean, the thing is, Josh Bell being at the top of our lineup definitely gives us another dimension. But man, the next level to go to is if Brinson gets going, his on-base percentage goes up, then we're really going to be in business, because I think Brinson does have potential. He has speed at that leadoff position, but once he starts to get on base a lot, I think this lineup will be taking, you know, their level of play up a level, a notch or two. So we do go on to win this one as Michael Fulmer does pitch a complete game, and he only gives up 5 hits, and we only get 5 hits. So 3-1 in the first game of this series. But then we, in the second game, we only get 4 hits. And like I said, this is what I'm talking about. We just have games where we just like disappear. And as we lose the second game, we move on to this third game in this series as DeSclafani is on the mound facing Cabrera here, the first batter of the game. And look at the game cheating me. Josh Bell gets a line drive right at him in right field. And look at this. He turns around right on the ball marker. The ball goes right under his arm. And somehow the game cheats me and gives up a leadoff double. But Josh Bell does get this animation at least. Gets it in before the runner tags. So with one out, here comes the batter up to the plate, and DeSclafani does get a little dribbler back to the mound. So with two outs facing Jay Bruce, he hits one deep to center field, but we do get out of the inning after that just horrible animation. So we are facing Noah Syndergaard in the last game of this season. He's 8-2, pitching pretty good. Look at those strikeouts and look at those walks. I mean, just a huge, almost a 3-1 ratio. And it's going to be tough in this game. So here we are at the top of this lineup. Like I said, we've been trying to drive in runs early in this game, get the top of the lineup going, but Lewis Brinson does ground out. But Josh Bell continues a pretty good season, hitting over 300 at this point, hits one to the left side, and Manny Machado comes up, moved him up into the three hole this game just to try it out, and he hits a little broken bat pop fly to the first baseman, and the first baseman feels it. So Domingo Santana comes up in that four spot. Now we switch them around, and Domingo Santana drives one to the left center gap, and we finally get a first run in the first inning. And nice start. I mean, I'll take it, because we've been wanting to get runs early in games, and Domingo Santana does just that. So Justin Bour comes up, and he's hot. He hit a homer in the last game. He hits another one this game, and that one was a mistake by Syndergaard, a fastball right over the middle, and that is going to be gone. And Syndergaard doesn't make many mistakes, and that time he definitely made one. But up to bat with two outs, Realmuto just not getting it done this year, hitting below 220, and we're going to probably look to address that a little bit. Look at our options, because going into the playoff season and going into September, we're going to need to get some production from the catcher position, especially since JT Realmuto doesn't have bad attributes. He's just underachieving. I mean, I think that's all it is. And going into free agency, I think that's going to hurt him a little bit. And it really is. I mean, I think it's going to hurt him. And I don't think right now my mindset is that we're not going to extend him. We're not going to give him another contract offer. But he is cheap. I looked at what he's asking for. He's asking for under $2 million. So maybe if, you know, the stars align and maybe Taylor Ward doesn't turn out to be the guy that we want. Or maybe, you know, we'll see how it goes in during the September call-ups if Taylor Ward does live up to the expectation. But speaking of Taylor Ward, I have an update for him actually later in this video, as Jung Ho Gang does pop up to the catcher here in the seventh inning, and Johnny Giovitella, who's back in the lineup off of the DL, he pops out to center field. So now we take this 3-1 game into the latter parts of this game, and here in the eighth inning, giving up a liner to the right center gap as Josh Bell cannot get to that one as it goes to the wall. Lewis Brinson comes up firing, but not before a double to start out this inning. And DeScafani pitching pretty decent up to this point, but here he is giving up another base hit up the middle. So guys on the corners with one out here in the eighth inning. They do bring in Brandon Nimmo to pinch hit for the pitcher. And on 3-2 count, one out, he hits one. That one gets through the hole on the left side. And now it's going to be a 3-2 game, and these games are crucial, so I have to bring in my best relievers as Ramos comes in out of the bullpen, and he does get a pop up to right field, and Josh Bell is going to hold the runner at second. So Ramos does get to see the next batter, but he does walk him, and he walks him right into Brandon Belt. So on a 1-2 count, curveball in the dirt. And that's exactly why we traded for him. Ramos gets out of the jam with only one run of damage that inning. And on to the ninth inning, we do actually bring in Tony Zitch because we did pinch hit for the pitcher in the top of the ninth. I mean, in the bottom of the eighth. And Tony Zitch comes in trying to get the save, but it's just not looking good. So we do have to bring in our actual closer, Bartolo Colon Jr., and can he get us the win in this game? And on a 1-2 count, he does get the ground ball, and that is going to be it for this game. We do sneak out of this series, winning it 2-1, and we do steal the series as we create like a little bit of a gap between New York, at least one game we gain on them. So now we're moving on to this Washington series, and we know they're going to be tough because they have the offense and they have the pitching. I think New York's offense struggles a little bit. They do have good pitching. But before hopping into that series, I wanted to evaluate JT Realmuto and look at him again. He's hitting .217. On-base percentage is not even at .300. So I'm going to make a move. I'm going to move up Taylor Ward. I know I said I didn't want to, but it's just too bad. I mean, the offense by JT Realmuto is just too bad, and I can't ignore it any longer. So I have to bring up Taylor Ward, and he's at AAA. And AAA, they're not going to make the playoffs. They're not having a great season. Our hitters are having a good season, but, I mean, we're not doing anything as far as pitching goes. The only pitcher we really have at the AAA level is Braxton Garrett. So he's the only one doing good for us. So we had decided to move up Taylor Ward for his first game. So we're going on the road here and facing this Nationals team, and we're facing Gio Gonzalez, who we usually struggle against. I mean, we struggle against him. He has a pretty good repertoire, but we're going to be looking to get going early on in this game as Domingo Santana gets robbed that time by Tommy Pham in right field. So here comes Machado up with two outs, and he gets a pitch to hit. He hits it hard to the left side, and now it's going to be guys on first and second here with Adrian Beltre in the lineup versus lefties for us. And on a 3-2 count, the runners are on the move. That one's going to drop in to right field, and we're going to get another run in the first inning. So I like this trend that we're going on as Justin Bour comes to the plate, and he gets a pitch to hit on the inside part of the plate, and that one sneaks into the outfield. So now we get on the board for another run. So now Taylor Ward comes to the plate for his first at bat as a major leaguer. And with a guy in scoring position, he cannot come through for the Miami Marlins. But we do get two runs in that inning, and that's actually a pretty good change. I mean, from what we've experienced in the past, I mean, I'll take it. So here is Jose Urania up, Here in the second inning, bunting over Leury Garcia after the walk there. So Lewis Brinson comes up, and you know he's a pretty good hitter versus left-handers. And here he gets a hold of a pitch, drives it to left field as a runner does come in to score. And that is going to be a 3-0 lead. But we're not done in this inning as Josh Bell comes up, and he hits one up the middle, and that is going to be another run. So 4 runs here in the first 2 innings for the Marlins, and maybe our offense is finally starting to get going. So here is Brinson coming up here in the 5th inning this time, and remember, he can hit versus lefties, but this time he does ground out to the shortstop as Josh Bell comes up next, and he gets a hit up the middle. So Josh Bell, I'm telling you, man, the transition, I mean, just the pickup of him has just been great as Domingo Santana follows him up with a big fly, and that's going to be a 6-0 lead here for the Miami Marlins on the road. So, I mean, very uncharacteristic of us to have this kind of offense, and I'm liking what I'm seeing. I really am liking what I'm seeing from this lineup now. I think it's finally starting to come together as the 7th inning approaches, and Lewis Brinson takes one deep, and that one's over the wall. And Lewis Brinson actually quietly has over 20 home runs in this season, and that one is going to be a big one as I think that's his 22nd home run of the year as the Marlins go on to defeat the Nationals 7-2 in this game off of 9 timely hits as Brinson shows that he can do some things, man. He has the power. He has the potential. That's the thing. He has that A potential. Remember, he's going to progress really nice, and especially since, you know, he's hitting about 250 this year. He's hitting 220 last year. I expect him to be close to like 280 come the following year because, I mean, if he can just keep improving, he's going to prove to be one of those guys that's just going to be a superstar on this team in the future. But we do move on to the next game in this series. You see it's a critical situation. We do give up a walk-off hit, and we do actually end up dropping two out of the three to the Nationals. So they gain a little ground on us. So now we move on to that last series. Remember, we went Mets, Nationals, Mets. And now we move on to the top of the 9th inning here in a critical situation as Domingo Santana does have a runner in scoring position with a chance to tie it up. And Brinson as well, but he pops up to the center fielder that time. And that is going to be an out as we're kind of slipping a little bit. That's 3 games in a row that we lose. So now we move on to another critical situation, but this time we have the game in hand 8-0, and we go on to win that one 8-2. But in the last game of this series, another close game versus the Mets. This one 0-0 going into the top of the 9th inning. I don't know why they wanted me to play this critical situation out of all ones. They made me play the one that Josh Bell's hit streak was on, and it was a 0-0 game. But somehow, we actually end up simming forward, and we win it 1-0. So we're still kind of ahead in this division. I think we kind of broke even with the Nationals and the Mets. I think we all went 5-5 in our last 10 games, which we'll look at in a second. Yeah, so if you look at this, look, we all went 5-5, so nothing really changed. We didn't really gain any ground. We didn't lose any ground in the division. So, you know, good thing, you know, a team like the Phillies aren't taking advantage of this because, like I said, like when we win, they win. When we lose, they lose. And it seems like that's been the trend going into September. So as long as we keep winning when they're losing, or winning when they're winning and losing when they're losing, I mean, I'm fine with it. I mean, we're surprising right now. We're a surprising team in the majors. We're not supposed to be leading this division. Remember, the Nationals are probably the best team top to bottom, but we're doing pretty good, especially our pitching staff. So hit subscribe, hit that like button, because next episode, we actually got the playoffs for Double A coming up. So you don't want to miss that one. Stay tuned. Let's get it.